Good evening. Thank you so much for joining us. It's a pleasure to have you on this beautiful Friday. My name is Adejisola Atiba. I'm going to be your host today. But before we start, we do have some preambles to do. So why are we here today? We're here to talk about our seniors. And the topic for today is your mental health matters. We have a subject matter expert, our daddy, that will be talking to us and enlightening us around how to take care of our mental health. But before we go that route, we're going to start with the anthem. So feel free to sit, stand, or however you feel as we take the anthem. Thank you so much, Eric. And so we will be going to the land acknowledgement, and I would like to call on Oreofeolua to read the English version, and right after, Toluwanimi will read the French version. Over to you, Orefe.
Thank you. In the spirit intent and the truth of the Civil Commission's recommendations, we acknowledge the traditional territories and also regard to being in the world CMP meetings. By learning, understanding, and acknowledging, we wish to pay respect to Turtle Island, Mother Earth, and to the rich indigenous history of Ontario. We recognize that our work takes place on traditional indigenous territories across Ontario. We also wish to acknowledge the CMP head office located on traditional indigenous territories of Huron-Wendat, Haudenosaunee, and most recently, the territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit. This territory is a part of the District One Spoon Treaty, under game between the Anishinaabe Bank, the Haudenosaunee, and the Island Nation, the peace we share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. This territory is all covered by the Upper Canada Treaties. We wish to express gratitude to Mother Earth and for the resources we are using, and honor all the First Nation, Métis, and Inuit people who have been living on the land since time immemorial. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Oreofe. Oreofe is a volunteer with CMP. Toluwanimi is a summer student intern. Please, over to you.
Merci. Dans l'esprit et l'intention des recommandations de la Commission de vérité et réconciliation, nous reconnaissons les territoires autochtones traditionnels sur lesquels nous nous réunissons au début de toutes les réunions du CNP. En apprenant, en comprenant et en reconnaissant, nous souhaitons rendre hommage à Turtle Island, Terre-mère et à la riche histoire autochtone de l'Ontario. Nous reconnaissons que nos travaux se tiennent sur les territoires autochtones traditionnels de l'Ontario. Nous tenons également à souligner que le siège social de CMP est situé sur les territoires autochtones traditionnels de Huron-Wendat, des Haudenosaunee et plus récemment sur le territoire des Mississaugas de New Credit. Ce territoire fait partie du traité Dish with One Spoon, un accord entre les Anishinaabeg, les Haudenosaunee et les nations alliées, et ce, pour partager et entretenir pacifiquement les ressources autour des Grands Lacs. Ce territoire est également couvert par les traités du Haut-Canada. Nous souhaitons exprimer notre gratitude à la Terre-Mère et pour les ressources que nous utilisons et honorer tous les peuples des Premières Nations, Métis et Inuits qui vivent sur la Terre depuis des temps immémoriaux. Merci.
Merci, Toluwanimi. For those that do not understand French, everything she said is correct. And so this is what our agenda looks like. We've done the anthem, the land acknowledgement. I'll be going ahead to talk about CMP and upcoming events. We'll say, you know, we'll appreciate our local businesses. And then our subject matter experts will be speaking about your mental health matters. So if you please go to the next slide. So these are the upcoming events. Please, if you're not speaking, so that we can have a good event, if you please mute yourselves. These are the upcoming speakers. Next week, we'll have Dr. Oyabioye, who will be talking about finance matters. And just because we know that finance and financial literacy is really, really important for ourselves and our seniors, we're going to be having two sessions of that. And of course, staying well and, you know, being physically healthy is really, really important. And so Adenike Charles is not a senior, but we need her to come and tell us how to stay healthy because that's our trait. So we'll be having Adenike on July 14th. Please, next slide. About CMP. CMP is a nonprofit that has been in the business of changing lives since 2018. The focus is to support people of African heritage in terms of networking, mentoring, sponsoring, supporting small businesses, being role model for our children since we've been doing that for over 5 years now. And we're really happy where we are. And that's why we encourage everyone to join us in this process so that we can continue to impact ourselves and impact lives as we go along in the journey. So to learn more about us, please go to our website, www.cmpngo.ca, and you will learn the story behind CMP. And so to our supporters, Black Professional in Tech Network, RBC Government of Canada, they've been supporting us. We couldn't do all this without them. And to our partners, the Public Service and Procurement Canada, if you are a small business, you really want to join one of our events on procurement. Early childhood, it's important for new people coming into Canada to understand the Canadian education system and how they can support themselves. Windbeam Microlending is an organization, a charitable organization that supports newcomers that needs to do some form of certification to be able to get their foot in the door of their profession. Next slide. And so a lot of small businesses have been supporting us to allow us to, you know, keep our lights on for the past 5 years. And so we do want to say thank you to them. Please go ahead. Thank you. Thank you so much, Eric. So if you're interested in supporting CMP and you're a small business owner, please reach out to us. All these small businesses that we've just showcased, you can find them on our website again at www.cmpngo.ca. So who do we have today that will be talking to us about your health matters? I mean, your mental health matters. Today we have with us Dr. Greg Osagie. I've actually had the pleasure of knowing him for, I don't know, maybe 3 decades now. He's a physician, a medical director of Divine Medical Center, Ikoyi, Nigeria. He's the pastor in the Redeemed Christian Church of God. He's happily married to Pastor Mrs. Bola Osagie, who also happens to be my sister, a chartered accountant and banker. They are blessed with children and a grandchildren. So please join me to give a warm virtual welcome to Dr. Greg Osagie.
Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It's nice being here. I want to thank you for the opportunity given to me to be part of this program. It's the first of series that you have for the professionals that belong to this council. I want to thank you so much. I want to thank your team, Eric, Toluwanimi, for organizing this powerful program that is profiting the entire community, communities in Canada. Thank you very much. And I want to welcome everyone online, Zoom, to this program. I'm sure tonight you will learn a lot from your mental health state and the mental health state of those around you. So I will just proceed without wasting much time. I will share my screen so that everyone can have a look at it. Okay. So the theme for tonight is your mental health matter. Your mental health matters. I've been introduced by the president of this council. So I will just proceed by letting us know that this team can be better organized than today, because we live in a society and community where integration, relationships, love is needed to bind us. And especially Canada is a place where you have diversity, diversity of culture, diversity of race, diversity of language. So nothing can put us together than when we all live healthily and mentally so that we can be able to fulfill and achieve purpose. So today, like I said, we'll be talking about your mental health matters. Your mental health matters. And I'll quickly run through what I have as agenda for this evening. Number one, we'll be talking about defining mental health and associated disorders. We'll be talking about prevalence and relevance within our community, because we live in a community. So we all need to be well to relate well with each other. There are some misconceptions about mental health. We'll also talk about it. We will talk about understanding the role science plays in mental health. What is the physiology? What is the pathophysiology? What is the disease process? How does this mental health, mental illness come about? What is stability mentally? What is instability? We'll talk about it. We'll talk about mental health illnesses by age demographics. Talk about protective factors. There are things we ought to do in our community that would prevent mental illnesses. Talk about it. We also talk about assessing resources and seeking medical attention for those who've developed this illness. So what do you do? How do we help them? We also talk about supporting family and friends, supporting family and friends. So an overview. You see, many who are mentally ill do not even want to talk about it. Many live in denial. And so many also do not even want to seek medical help. But tonight, I want to debunk the myth behind mental health. That mental ailment is not more than any other ailment that we have, any other systemic ailment that we have in our bodies. It's as good as somebody who has hypertension, somebody who has diabetes, somebody who has a lung disease, somebody who has a colonic or gastrointestinal disease. So it's just like any other disease in the body. So whoever has a mental illness should not feel that, oh, he's gotten one terrible ailment that cannot be reported. So the concept, the discipline of mental health and psychology in as a sub-specialty in entire healthcare is often overlooked. Not enough attention is given to it, especially in Africa and in the eastern part of the world. The reason being that, you know, poor education, poverty, unawareness, and some religious factors too, because if you declare, if you agree you are mentally ill, it means you are demon-possessed. So there are some negative stereotypes that we need to debunk so that people can begin to assess mental health care. Now, we'll start with health. What is health? Now, you need to know what is normal before you begin to know what is abnormal. That's why in the training of a medical doctor, you spend so much time letting him know, teaching him about what is normal. Because if he or she knows what is normal, it will be very easy to pick out what is abnormal. We're going to define what is health. We're going to define what is mental health. Then we now go to what is mental illness. Now, what is health? When we say a man is healthy, when we say a man is healthy, what are we talking about? Now, the World Health Organization came up with a combo of different parts of the body, a combo of wellness as an integration to define what health is. And this was further refined in 1987 in Amata, sorry, 1978 in Amata, in a small town in the then Soviet Union. So they came together with a full bouquet of what health is. And they define health as a state of complete, now follow me gradually, a state of complete physical, mental, social well-being, and not mainly absence of disease or infirmity. Now, they came up with this because some people say they are well when they are even poor. They can't even afford the basics of life. They say they are well. Some will say they are well because they don't have a fever. Some will say they are well because they don't have peptic ulcer. They will say they are well because they don't have any growth in their body. But it goes beyond that. So health, defined by WHO, World Health Organization, is a state of complete physical. That means your physical body should be okay. This physical body entails your systems, your heart, your blood vessels, your chest, your lungs, your intestines, your brain, your head, your neck, your eyes, physical, should be completely good. Your mental state should be okay, your cognition, your behavioral pattern, your memory, your cerebral component should be good. That's a mental component. Your social well-being should be that you should be able to be, you should be able to relate well in your community. You should be useful to yourself, useful to others. You should not be a deviant. So when you put this all together, put this whole thing together, the physical state, the mental state, and the social state, and they are in a well state, you say, yes, this person has a good health. Therefore, we say health is a state of complete physical, mental, social well-being, and not merely absence of disease or infirmity. Now, we know health, as it is known, is not determined by a single factor. From what I've said, definitely cannot be determined by a single factor. It exists on a continuum and is influenced by a number of factors in our community, a number of factors, commonly referred to as social determinant of health. We're talking about economic stability. If there's an economic downturn, of course, we're going to have a lot of issues. A lot of people are going to become depressed, are going to become social deviant. Of course, the evidence we had with COVID-19 and the restriction is an example. That one happened just 2 years ago. If the social environment in the community is not in order, we're going to have issues. If the neighborhood, if you have a very toxic neighborhood and the environment is unfriendly, you're going to have challenges with health. If you have increased burglary activity into the homes, people are not safe in their houses, you're going to have issues. If there's no good health care, we're going to have a lot of issues. And also when the people are not educated, children are not educated, we're going to have a lot of issues. Therefore, these determinants should be available in our community, in our neighborhood, to be able to secure good health for our people. Next slide. So, having said this, so what exactly is mental health? We've talked about what is health and what is a component of good health. So, what is mental health? Now, mental health is a state of mental well-being that enables people to cope with the stresses of life. Now, if you're able to cope, you will be able to realize your abilities. You can learn and work well and begin to contribute to the community. Because if you're not well, if your mental state is not balanced, you cannot contribute to the community. In fact, you'll be a risk factor to the environment. So a mental health state is a mental well-being that enables the people to cope with life stress. Excuse me. Realize their abilities. Now you must understand that life is stressful. The moment a child is born to this world, he begins to go through stress. Because a child that was fully dependent on the mother in the womb now begins to take care of his or her own respiration. And she must breathe, or he must breathe. And he or she begins to learn how to eat. These were things that were not there before. And as he grows, you begin to teach him how to sit, how to walk. These are not easy. These are stress components to life. And beyond that, he begins to go to school. After school, he begins to think of how to get a job and begin to start his life. So life is full of stress. And in between all these, there are periods of ups and downs. So a man or a woman must be able to cope with this and realize his or her potentials and learn to work also and begin to contribute to the community. So when a man is able to realize, a woman realize this, when I say man, I mean man or woman. I'm not being sexist here. You find me talking about man or woman. When I say man, I mean man or woman. So when a man is able to realize this and able to navigate his way through these stress factors and begin to learn and work and contribute to the society, we say this man has mental health. And it constitutes his emotions, his psychological state, and his social well-being. Now, it is responsible for his thought, for his emotions and behavior. So a man that is able to handle this, is able to have good relationship with his environment, is able to live well as a neighbor, and is able to contribute to the well-being of society. And we must understand that, and it's important that this mental health is important for every age group, from childhood to old age. And that is why tonight, I will not just be talking about seniors. I'll be talking about mental health as it cuts across all strata of life. Because I realize of what you use as seniors, you know what is mental health. And you are unable to pick it up in the young child who lives with you. You are unable to pick it up in your own child. Of what use you seniors knowing about mental health, you are unable to tell that a young adult is beginning to become mentally ill. Because early diagnosis and early diagnosis of this ailment will go a long way to achieving full treatment and full cure for this set of people. So, mental health illness, its range, what is mental health illness? So having said all this, we talked about mental health, talked about health in itself, having said this, so what is mental health illness? Therefore, we can imagine that when there's a derangement, when there's an alteration, when there's a deviation from all what I've said so far, that person is said to be mentally ill. So mental health ailments can be defined as a range of health conditions that involve changes in an individual's emotion. Those things I've said about your emotions, your behavior, your thinking, your memory, when they become altered, when there's a deviation from what is a set norm, then you can say this person is mentally ill. And these conditions are often associated with distress and a problem altering activities of daily living. Because when a man or woman is mentally ill, living well daily becomes difficult. He or she will be unable to cope with daily life challenges. So it's something which we need to note very well and pay attention tonight so that we can begin to be of relevance. Because if we get knowledge, we can be of use to your environment. I want us to have that knowledge tonight. So mental health illnesses present in diverse form. That we must also know. In diverse form. Some are mild and minimal, you know, that, you know, whoever has it can still cope with the daily life, you know. You can still manage, you can still navigate your way through life. Some of these are phobias, little anxiety here and there, you know, little stress factors here and there. While others could be very severe as that they will need medical attention, they will need to be hospitalized, and they will need some kind of rehabilitation after treatment. So it's very important for us to know that mental ailments comes in shades and in all kinds of forms. Some are mild, some are very severe. Quickly, I'll run through this. The disorders that we see in mental ailments, not by any means exhaustive. We have mood disorders, and it ranges from depression. Depression is when a man or woman, is not motivated, you are sad, your esteem is low, he has no drive, he has low energy. And now to what we call the bipolar. Bipolar, bi means two, from two poles, ranging from the one that is excited, the one that has high energy, to the one that has low energy. And those days, we used to call it manic depressive disorders, you know, medicine. But this is a better term now, the more modern term, the bipolar disorders. Like I said, it ranges from the one that is high, manic, almost manic or hypomanic. You know, his mood is high, he's full of energy, excited, and easy to move, and he goes, and he's not down. So the man who is sorrowful, who is sad, a man who does not feel like getting up, who is not encouraged, a man who is discouraged and disillusioned. Now, to premenstrual dysphoric disorder, that's PMDD disorders. Now, what happens with these ones? These are hormonal interplay, typically common with women, with the interplay of estrogen and progesterone, hormones of menstruation, that seriously affects them, that their mood is altered, and it can be really, really, really very serious with them. Then up to anxiety disorders. People who are anxious, panic disorders, and people who easily get anxious when they are out there in society. People who cannot even stand to talk to a fellow neighbor. It's as bad as that. Then we talk about psychotic disorders. I'm not going to dwell on this because I'm going to find some time to talk about them as we go on. Psychotic disorders as in schizophrenia and delusional disorders. Schizophrenia means schiz, means two part. You know, these people are in a world of their own. They live their own life. They think what they are doing is right. Meanwhile, they are sincerely wrong, but they think they are right. So their lives is split into two. They have a part which you see as real, and they live in a different world of theirs. It's schizophrenia. I'll talk about it later. Also, the other component of mental illness is personality disorders. You have the obsessive compulsive disorders. These ones, they believe in what they are doing, and that is the way it must be done. They are stereotyped. It must be done in one way, and there's nothing you can do to convince them that it has to can be done the other way. The other one is paranoia. They are paranoid personality. They're always afraid that somebody is going to kill them or destroy them, or somebody's against them. They are paranoid. Another range that we'll talk about even as we go ahead tonight is substance abuse disorders, alcohol, opioid abuse, marijuana, fentanyl, which is a recent thing that is causing havoc, even in the US. Then eating disorders, like ranging from not wanting to eat to excessive eating. So as seniors and as parents, if your kids or your work came back from school, and you suddenly discover that there's a change in their eating habit. Now, watch it, be careful. There might be something brewing there, because mental illness starts more often at an early age, and it may not manifest until much later in life. So statistics, what is the prevalence? So if we know the prevalence, then we'll be on the watch out, so that we can begin to see that these things are really in existence with us. So mental illness does not discriminate. Anyone, regardless of age or your gender or income or social status or race or ethnic group, can be affected. Now, look at some figures we got here in Canada. Nearly one in five, that's 20% adults in Canada, will experience some form of mental illness. That's high. One out of five. And at age 40, one in two Canadians have or have had a mental illness at age 40. That's high. Now look again. Although mental illness can occur at any age, 3/4 of all mental illnesses begin by age 24. So at age 24, for a young graduate, now, what we are saying here, 3/4 of those mental illness that we discover, 3/4 of them would have begun before age 24. Now, this is the sex component of it now. Women are 2 times more likely to have mood and anxiety disorders than men. Why? Because of the hormonal interplay. The hormones, you know, can actually make them have more mood disorders and anxiety disorders than men. Individuals with long-term physical health conditions, such as chronic from arthritis, from cardiovascular diseases, prolonged hypertension, hypertensive heart disease, prolonged lung disease, as you find in bronchitis, as you find in dust-related chest infections. You know, individuals that have been battered over time with certain chronic diseases are more likely to suffer from mood disorders and even depression. In Canada, an average of 11 suicides occur per day. This is significantly high, affecting people of all ages and background. So we must begin to, because Canada is a peaceful country. And most people are coming down here because it's a peaceful place. But then we should take note, because we are beginning to have an increased disorder. 11 suicides occur daily. That's a figure that the government should watch out for and the health sector should watch out for. 25% of Black Canadians seek mental health treatment as compared to 40% of whites. Especially the fact that the Black community tend to have a higher rate of depression. Why? Because the Blacks are more spiritual. The Black tend to feel that, look, if I go report, then my entire life story, it's going to be available to the entire world. Blacks are more secretive. But then this ought not to be so. Now, there are some myths, some misconceptions that is attended to mental illness. There are certain things that are not true, but then it's the origin is from most of us, from our background, and from where we are, especially the Africans. We think and we feel that mental illness is a white man's problem. Africans do not experience mental ailment. This is not true, it's a myth. That mental ailment is a result of witchcraft. So for those who are of some religious sect, they will say it's not their portion. Even when the symptoms are there and it's obvious, they say it's not their portion. And that is why we need to pick up these disorders early before it gets to the stage of a split personality, when it becomes very obvious to the community, so that children and teenagers do not experience mental illness. It's not true. People with mental illness can simply snap off, if they try hard enough. This is not true. That you can pray depression away. Yes, it can be prayed away, but then if you need medical attention, seek medical attention. That people with mental illness just need attention. You know, some parents will say, look, this boy used to come out and sit with the family, eat with the family on the table. But these days, he goes into his room to eat. Maybe he's seeking attention. Yes, but it's possible, but try and probe more into the life of your world and be sure that it's not the early state of mental ailment. Excuse me. Mental ailments are brought about by weakness in character. That's not true. That seeking help from a therapist will expose one's personal life and reflect badly on the family. That's not true. Medical practitioners are taught to treat case for case confidentially. So if you seek medical advice and go for treatment, no one else is going to know about your medical history except your physician or your therapist. Now, there's a science behind mental illness. Although we do not know definitely what the cause of mental ailments or illnesses are, but research has shown that by and large, a proportion of it are due to imbalance in the chemical substances in the brain. There are some biochemical substances secreted by the brain, and these are neurotransmitters. They are what the brain uses to transmit information from the brain itself to the body. And they are the ones that will tell you, stay where you are. They are the ones that will tell you, frown. They are the ones that will tell you, begin to smile, begin to be happy. There are portions of the brain that regulate this. Joy, happiness, satiety, satisfaction. There are portions in the brain that regulate this. And there are transmitters, there are chemical substances which are called transmitters that make sure these things come about. And when there is a deficit in them, or when they are producing excess amount, you begin to have changes in the way you think, begin to have changes in your emotion, changes in behavior. So these chemical substances are majorly three of them, although by no means exhausting. I want to talk about these three major ones. They are dopamine, serotonin, and non-epinephrine. Dopamine, serotonin, and non-epinephrine. So I said they are in the brain. They are chemical substances. They transmit impulses from the brain, and they begin to direct the body. They tell you what to do. They're the one that will tell you, no, don't go out. Stay in your room. Don't see anybody. So as we begin to understand this, we'll begin to know how they affect us. Now, quickly, dopamine is a chemical substance secreted in the brain. It regulates your emotions, how you respond to situations. Like we said, life itself is stress. Everything that we go through in life brings about stress. The work you go through, that you have to wake up early in the morning to go and work, that you have to meet up with your target, is all stress. And as you get home, if you are married, if you have a family, you have to also take care of the family, it's stress. That you find yourself not sleeping enough number of hours as you auto, is stress. And if you have to drive through traffic at times, drive hours, you know, 1.5 hours, 2 hours a day to get to your place of work, is stress. That you meet up with a boss who is an unfriendly boss, is stressful. So this chemical substance are needed to be secreted to help you. There are some that allays your anxiety, and there are some that will heighten it. So if at the time your boss is stressing you in the office, and the chemical substance that you allay the anxiety is not in enough quantity, what happens? You become stressed, and you begin to showcase all manners of symptoms of mental illness. So dopamine controls our emotion. It controls our feelings of pleasure, satisfaction, and motivation. So low level of it, what happens to it? It now makes people addictive, and it now begins to make you unsatisfied. Satiety will be far from you. You will be unmotivated. While high levels will begin to shoot you to the other side of split personality, can even cause psychosis and even cause attention disorders. There is a serotonin which regulates mood very well. That is the social behavior. Your appetite, it regulates your attention to things happening in your environment. Serotonin will determine whether you are aloof, whether you are apathetic or not. Whether you respond to what's happening in your environment is serotonin. So low level of it is associated with fluctuating hormones and gives rise to high stress disorders. While high levels can cause anxiety and even depression. Now, the third one I want to talk about, like I said, these three are by no means all the chemical substances in the brain. The third one is epinephrine, non-epinephrine. This is a typical hormone that is secreted in the body that makes you be able to respond to real stress now. We call them the fight, the fright, or flight hormone. The fright, you see something that frightens you, a stress factor. You walked out of your compound at night and you see a raccoon. What happens to you? You are frightened. And the next thing is, what do I do? Do I fight now or do I fly? Now you can decide. Either you fight and kill the raccoon and wait for the body that regulates the life of an animal, whether it becomes an animal abuse or not. Or whether you're going to fly, more often than not, people will say in Canada, look, let me run away. So the hormones, adrenaline, begins to increase your heart rate. The similar reason is that it pumps more blood into your muscles. And when that blood is pumped in, at that same time, your pupils are dilated. You can see more. Then you decide whether to run away or to fight. But again, these are stress factors that should just exist for just a short period. It becomes a problem to anybody if this stress existed for too long a time. You can imagine a man whose BP is always on the edge, always on the high, and your pulse rate is always high. The heart is not tailored to pump at that rate. The heart should pump when you are anxious, when you are exposed to stress. That stress plateau should go off and leave you with a normal heart rate. But if this continues, it gives rise to anxiety, it gives rise to chronic stress, and this can lead to disorders in the body. Now, there are risk factors. There are things that predisposes a people or a community to mental illness. There are risk factors, and they exist in our environment. And some are de novo. I mean, they exist inside of us. Some are genetic. There are things we got that was coded when we were conceived in our mother's womb. I will classify them as the biological factors, you know, which are hormone-based. I've said it earlier, the hormone-based can, these are hormone imbalances and medical conditions. The second one I'll talk about is the genetic predispositions. Now, having a family history, a member family with a mental illness predisposes one to having a mental illness. One is the likelihood to have a mental illness if you have a close relation with a mental illness. In early life, you know, environment, you know, if one came out from an environment that is toxic, excuse me, a home where there's no love, a home where the father is always on the edge, where the mother is always on the edge, where there's no love, where there is shouting, there's anger, there's bitterness. Such people can have their life modified and they begin to develop mental ailments. So this is so important that for our seniors, we need to create a warm, loving environment for our children so that they can grow up to become responsible adults and become adults that also have compassion and love. Because a child that never grew up in an environment of love and compassion will never, ever, is more unlikely to show love and compassion in the community. So we also have some personality traits that can also predispose to mental illness. If one has a low esteem, an introvert, an extrovert, can either cause depression or anxiety. Traumatic stress disorders, you know, PTSD is a notable cause of mental illness. You know, loss of a loved one, loss of a major income in a family, you know, traumatic incidences, natural disasters can actually cause mental illness. Drug abuse, you know, alcohol abuse, and all manners of drug abuse, cocaine, marijuana, fentanyl, can distort the constituent, the flow of this chemical substance in the brain and lead to mental ailments. Now, we must understand that whatever becomes of any man in life, whatever you become, how you respond to the environment, how you relate with others, your behavioral pattern, your at times your intellect, your cognition is a function of your inherited coded gene substance in your body and the environment. There's always an interplay. I say it's 50-50. Now there's a gene that we inherit from our parents that should determine how we behave, how we carry on. But that gene can be modulated by our environment. I put here the interaction of genes and experience affect mental health also. Genes are not destiny. Our genes contain instruction. They are coded instruction that tell our bodies how to work, how to behave, how to respond to situations. But as coded as those information are, we have an environment, what I would call, this study was done, the Center on the Developing Child in 2017, that there's a chemical signature of our environment that can authorize or prevent the instruction from your gene. If your gene was coded to make you an anxious personality, to make you an extrovert, to make you a hypomanic person. Again, if you grew up in an environment that is calm, an environment where There's love, a peaceful, gentle environment. That environment can modulate, can suppress your gene and begin to make you live normal, live peacefully, suppressing that genetic trait that you got from your parents. So mental illness in children and youth. So mental illness in children and youth are relatively common and not to be overlooked, because most mental illness starts in children and in youth. So early detection and intervention plays a significant role in better health outcomes. So if they are picked up early, that's why I said this seminar is going to cut across all age groups, because the seniors also need to know and discover and pick up early signs in their children or children in the community. Most common mental illnesses within this demographic falls into anxiety. I've talked about anxiety before, mood disorders, ADHD, that's attention and behavioral disorders, substance abuse, talked about this, we need to go a bit. So many children and youth will exhibit different behavior and moods as there is no clear-cut set signs and symptoms. They will exhibit different mood and behavioral patterns. And like I said, it's a spectrum. And I'm going to tell us the spectrum. I've listed it out there. And you will discover that some of this spectrum, you know, exists in an average normal child. So you need to now be attentive and observe your world and see if these symptoms are what is existing for over a long period. Or if these are symptoms that just come and in a jiffy are out. And these symptoms are avoidance of family and friends. Like I said, a child who used to be very available to the family, who used to, you know, phone of the family, suddenly come back from school, and all he wants to do is to stay on his own. Wow, be careful, begin to watch that child. If this persists for so long, begin to interview and begin to try and investigate this child. Lack of energy or motivation. A child who used to wakes up in the morning and begin to help with the house chores, suddenly finds interest, sleeping all day. Watch out. Having frequent outbursts of anger, changes to sleeping or eating habits, no longer engaging in activities, watch out. Activities which he ab initio enjoyed, watch out. Experiencing frequent mood swing, watch this child out. Obsession with body weight gain and appearance, when they suddenly become too conscious of their body. Am I getting too fat or too thin? Watch out. Increased risk-taking behavior, drinking a lot and using drugs. The parents or the seniors in the environment have to watch out. Now, as parents and guardians, it's important that we know that some of these symptoms and signs could be normal. That is why I said watch out. But if they exist for too long, we have to now begin to interrogate our children and possibly seek help for them. If the severity is high, if it's intense, beyond what a normal average child should go or should experience, we need to begin to find out and seek help. Again, if what we are seeing in them is inappropriate for their age, we need to also begin to investigate and seek for help. Now, mental ailment in seniors and mental ailment in middle-aged and seniors. Now, the world population is currently aging. Unlike in Africa, where we by and large still have a very young population. But in the developed world, in Canada, but thank God for immigrants now. But Canada is aging, the US is aging. Now, before now, we had a projection of about 12%. Currently, we have a 12% aging population, that is seniors 60 and above. But the projection is that by 2050, we're going to have almost twice this population of people. That's those who are 60 and above will be making up to about 22% of the entire population. So because we're having a larger group of aging population now, we should pay attention to mental health of our seniors. And mental health of our seniors, you know, cuts across from mid-age to old age, usually very complex, diverse, and prevalent. Unfortunately, these ailments can go undiagnosed. More so because at this age, nobody wants to show up because they are afraid of stigma. They are afraid of tradition. And how can I be the one now to now label this family as a family of mentally ill people? Because in some part of Africa, if you told somebody there's a mentally ill person in a family, nobody goes there to ask for the hand of a woman to marry. Nobody goes there for a wife. And if a young man from that family is coming to ask of your daughter a hand in marriage, they say, no, that family, no way, we're not, they are a family of mentally ill people. So we find out that people, because of stigma and tradition, they don't want to show up. And also at this age, they are afraid of losing their independence. Everybody wants to be independent. Of course, when they are labeled mentally ill, they will lose their independence. So although there are numerous mental ailments at this age, we're going to place our focus on just about four, which is anxiety, stress, disorder, depression, dementia, Alzheimer's disease, and schizophrenia. Anxiety, stress disorder, depression, dementia, Alzheimer's disease, and schizophrenia. Now, what is stress? We talked about stress. We said stress is a physical demand on the body. Now, ordinarily, the body should go through normal stress. The body was designed by God to navigate its way through a stressful environment. That your body should be able to cope with pressure in the environment. I've said it earlier, for a young baby born, the pressure that he has to take over his own respiration by himself is stress. That the baby now has to start eating, feeding himself, even though he has to just open his mouth, is stress. Going through school is stressful. Now, beginning to raise a family of your own is stressful. But God has given us enough things in place in the body for us to be able to do this. How? Because there are some chemical substances, there are hormones in the body that are stimulated when we go through stress. Steroids we have in the body are meant to help us go through stress, destabilize the body. I've talked about the chemical substances in adrenaline and non-adrenaline. They help us go through, but stress will cause disease for us if it is persistent, if it is continuous, if it's non-ending. So if you are going through stress that is non-ending, you can't sleep, you are constantly on the edge in the office, you are constantly overwhelmed by the work you have at home, then that is stress that could lead to a mental ailment. So that should be taken care of. Then you have anxiety. It's a feeling of intense fear, worry, and unease, which, unlike stress, can occur without any external trigger. What we said, something for stress, there's an external factor. You know, making life uncomfortable for you. But there are things in place in your body that is going to help you navigate. These stress factors, stressors, are external. But anxiety is de novo, or something in you that is provoking it is not of anything external. Or there might not be anything external provoking anything, but within you, you get anxious, you get afraid, and you are worried. Now, everyone at some point in life has experienced both stress and anxiety, like I said. But you should be able to navigate. It is when you are unable to navigate that you now come down with a physical or mental ailment. People with anxiety disorder may often find themselves excessively worrying about their past, about their present, even their future. They worry about their children. They worry about their job, worry about their tomorrow. No, if you allow me to use this word, I say they are warriors. They worry over everything. This is not supposed to be. If this is not taken care of, it can lead to some mental disorders. Our physical symptoms, which we will see from these, are panic attack. Some will come to you and say, "Doctor, I don't know. My heart is always racing. I feel like my heart is going to jump out of my chest." That's a panic disorder. "I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Something is disturbing, holding my blocking my airway." It's not the case of the policeman pressing on the neck of a man he's supposed to protect. "I can't breathe. There's no external factor, but cannot just breathe." Sweating profusely, difficulty with sleeping, dizziness, difficulty concentrating. These are symptoms of anxiety disorders. So causes we said earlier, these are stressful life, you know, family events, financial challenges, you know, you can't pay mortgage and the bank is on you, the house is about being taken away from you. You know, childhood trauma, chronic health disorders can cause this. So depression is a mood disorder that causes persistent feeling of intense sadness. That's depression. Of intense sadness, low mood, low drive, loss of energy. You are disillusioned, you are disenchanted. This is an example of a depressed man. You can see the picture of that elderly man there, who is, no, I'm sure now, looking at his past and probably beginning to think of what he ought to do that he didn't do, and he's looking down, you know, as if he's... No, apparently with a countenance of sadness. So that's depression. Although we all experience some feeling of sadness and lack of energy at one point in time or the other, like I said, but then this should not exist for too long. If it goes on for too long, it begins to bring about mental ailment. And what are the symptoms of depression? Hopelessness. Feeling of guilt. Yes, there are things you ought to do that you didn't do. Begin to feel, if I had known, I would have done it better. You begin to, you know, become an introvert. You begin to keep yourself to yourself. You no longer socialize. You become less productive. Nothing motivates you anymore. Some go drinking, some go smoking. Some even begin to contemplate suicide. These are symptoms of depression. If you have anyone going through this, you ought to counsel or seek help for the person. Because more often than not, the depressed man cannot tell you that he's depressed to the extent that he wants to seek help. But it's you, the neighbor, the friend, the one that is in the community, the brother, sister, that should help him seek help. And we must understand that the causal factor, what could provoke this, could be genetic. We said it before. Traumatic experience in the childhood period of the person. Abuse, loss of a loved one. Financial loss. Loss of job. Loneliness. Physical hurt. I need to run now, but my time is... Now, we'll talk about dementia. And we'll talk about Alzheimer's disease. This is common in the elderly, among the seniors now. Now, dementia is a broad term, it's a general term that describes a group of symptoms affecting, one, the memory of an elderly person, affecting the thinking of an elderly person, and the mood, the behavior and the social abilities of an elderly person. So dementia is a disease that is common with the seniors. Dementia could start from age 65, but by and large is restricted to senior. And we have loss of memory, coming on as an early symptom of dementia. Although memory loss alone cannot be labeled as dementia, there are some people that are beginning to lose memories. Their memories are not as cerebral as they used to be. But that alone is not enough for you to categorize somebody as dementic. But commonly, memory loss and some other symptoms are symptoms that you put in place as a combo to say, yes, this elderly man is beginning to get dementic. Now, Alzheimer's disease is the commonest cause of dementia. There are other causes. There are vascular causes. That means when there's a less supply of blood to a certain portion of your brain at that age, because of too much fat plug, you can begin to suffer from dementia. You have some other diseases that are due to metabolic products that are released into the brain can cause dementia. You can also have autoimmune diseases causing dementia. You can also have dementia coming from post-traumatic disorders, post-traumatic diseases like road traffic accidents, like automobile accident. That could actually be the genesis of dementia. But by and large, Alzheimer's disease is the commonest cause of dementia that we see. And it's a progressive degenerative brain disease. We say it's progressive because it keeps increasing. And more often than not, it's irreversible. And it leads to significant memory impairment. I don't want to go into details as to the pathophysiology because certain nauseous proteinous substances are secreted, that begins to get deposited in the cells of the brain. And they begin to hinder neurotransmission. The amyloid substance and tau substances, they are proteinous substances, they are implicated in this. So individuals over the age of 65 and those with a family history are at most risk. Those who are 65 and above are seniors, 65 and above, and those with a family history are more at risk. Now, the most common early symptoms, like I said earlier, includes difficulty recollecting old and new information. They tell you, look, come and see me tomorrow at 4 p.m. And tomorrow comes, and the person asked to come has come. And the elderly man says, what are you doing here? I say, Pap, you asked me to come today at 4 p.m. I can't remember saying so. So those are one of the early signs of dementia. You going around the house looking for where you kept the keys to the car. So those are early signs of dementia. If we have it, if anybody has it, you should start beginning to seek help. Now, other symptoms. Over time, symptoms worsen. I can include disorientation. Can include confusion, behavioral changes, difficulty speaking, language disorders, even difficulty swallowing, and difficulties walking. So on my display there, you can see where I put the early signs of Alzheimer's, difficulty completing familiar tasks, confusion with time and space, new problems with words, in speaking and in writing, misplacing things, inability to retrace steps, decrease or poor judgment. Now, quickly, I'll go through schizophrenia. This is a disorder of split personality. They are completely in a world of their own. Schizophrenia, it's a split personality. Literally, that's what it means. It's a psychotic disorder that causes an altered perception of reality. Their reality is altered. They are, like I said, in a world of their own. And of all the mental illnesses we mention or discuss, people with schizophrenia are most stigmatized and least understood. These are the ones you find that they begin to hear voices. They tell you somebody is talking about them in the next compound, that people are ganging up to harm them. They begin to hear voices. They begin to see things which another person sees, which means they begin to have auditory and visual hallucinations. Now, skis affect 1 in 100 people with symptoms usually beginning in late adolescence or early adulthood. So that's significant. 1 in 100 people will have schizophrenia, and it starts early. It's a long-term ailment with a variety of symptoms that can cause serious disability when left untreated. You have the paranoid schizophrenia, you have the obsessive schizophrenia, you have the catatonic schizophrenia. We say they are catatonic. They just stand still, stiff in the place, and they're looking at you, and you're looking at them. And they are aloof. They are not aware of the environment. That is the extreme case. You can see that is a proper, a re-altered state of perception. So main symptoms, I put the hallucinations, I've said the delusions, false belief that cannot be changed, the behavioral changes, they can become unkept, they can become so rough and dirty. Now again, causes could be genetic, it could be drug-induced, so on and so forth. So I move further. Now, there are things we can put in place in our environment. Thank God for the Council of Nigerian Professionals, for programs like this that try to educate us so that we can become better citizens and begin to contribute to our environment. I believe after this seminar, many of us will be better informed and we can be of use. We can detect and pick of early signs and symptoms of this in our environment and begin to help them. Now, there are things that can protect us from mental illness. So despite several complex factors that influence and increase the likelihood of mental illness, there are also various protective factors that can increase the likelihood of maintaining a good mental health. I'll run through it. Support, family support is crucial. Family support is crucial. You know, we are first of all a family before we became a community. So we should learn to support ourselves in our families. Those who are having challenges should be supported. Those who are not good enough should be helped to become good enough. Those who lack an environment should be aided so that they can become also sufficient. So family support. So developing healthy and adaptive way of coping with life challenges, stressors. Yes, learn to develop ways to sleep as you ought to sleep. You can't be sleeping 2-3 hours every day. That is damaging to the body. As scientists have said, and we know that terrible chemical substances are secreted, SROS and cisplatin and histamine are secreted when you don't sleep well. And these do a lot of damage to the brain. So you should develop a good lifestyle, a good work-life balance, to avoid stressors in our environment. And again, we should also learn to work with time, make sure we deliver what we want to deliver at the right time so that we don't start rushing to do our work at the last minute. Maintaining non-sedentary lifestyle by exercising and a good diet. A healthy diet. I mean, this cannot be overemphasized. We live in an environment where the government realized that, look, the people need to exercise, and they create parks all over the place. You don't have to walk too far from your home to get a park where you can go and make sure you make your life relevant and exercise regularly. Of course, there are places you can get fresh fruit, vegetables, and good meals to take without necessarily eating junk meals. I've said it before, good work-life balance, having a strong sense of identity and culture. Culture will help us avoidance of illicit drugs, alcohol will also help us. So belonging to a religious group will help us. Spiritual practices, meditation will help us. you know, having faith, you know, faith in the God that created you will help you. Faith also in your community can also help protect us from mental ailments. So, assessing resources and seeking medical treatment. Now, a very good step, first step, is to speak out to a trusted confidant. Don't bother yourself with stigma. Speak to somebody. When you notice anything's happening in you and you are beginning to live a very funny kind of life, speak to somebody. Have trust in somebody. Speak to your partner. Speak to your husband. Speak to your wife. To your parents. Speak to your children. Speak to a friend. Speak to a colleague that you trust. That you trust. You know, and they will help you. Don't isolate yourself. No, to isolate yourself is to destroy yourself. Seeking support from trained health professionals. Go to your family doctor. Let him know what is wrong with you. Go to your psychologist, your counselor. Don't be afraid that your matter is going to be on Al Jazeera or it's going to be on CNN. No, it's not going to be so. You know, doctors are trained to keep your secret secret. Three professionals are trained to do that. Your lawyer, your doctor, and your priest. They are trained to keep your secret secret. So tell them. Talk to somebody. Support group therapy sessions. Because this is a session that has people with life challenges. You know, people that are going through what you are going through too. When you think your case is worse, when you come to such therapy sessions, you see that your case is good and you are encouraged. And even if your case is bad, somebody there is able to tell you, give you his own life experience, and you can learn from it and also improve on your own. So a safe space, share your experience, as well as learn and connect with patients, who also went through these same challenges and they are better off now. You can call a health direct helpline. You know, thank God for where we are. There's a 999. You know, that you can call. They can help you. You know, they are there 24 hours, 7 days in a week. For those who become really, really, really bad, become violent, who become uncontrollable, yes, the health team are usually available to help. The knowledge is power. That is what we are doing now. Knowledge is power. That's why I said, look, I'm going to take this in across the board, both seniors and the young adults and the young should know about this. Knowledge is power. So educating oneself is key about signs and symptoms, which is what we have done in this short period. You know, through workshop, which is what we are doing. I want to thank the Council for Nigerian Professionals, you know, that has taken time to do this. You know, seminars like this will educate us. Public health website will also help us. You have the Public Health Ontario, you have the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, in the US, they are here. Center for Addiction and Mental Health, they are all over the place. And Government of Canada Mental Health Support is also available. They are all available to help us and to help our loved ones. Now, supporting a loved one. Now, what you must do and what you must not do. You know, number one, educating yourself about mental health condition and debunking the myth and misconception will help you and help your loved ones. Being present, patient, and providing a listening ear. Don't just wish off or tell off the complaint of a loved one or a neighbor or a friend. Don't tell him, look, it doesn't exist. When anyone comes to you that I'm noticing a pattern, a kind of change, listen, develop a listening ear, and be available to take him to a place where he can seek help if you cannot afford it, if you cannot provide it. Encourage them to seek professional help. Help them access support service. Offer to go with them for appointments. Don't just abandon them. Make time out to go with them for appointment. That will encourage them. Take care of yourself. And preventing caregiver burnout. Because if you have to be well and healthy to take care of a mentally ill person, if you are not well, you can't do that. You take care of yourself and make sure you don't have a burnout so that you can be strong, revitalized, to also help the one that is needing your help. See, treating and seeing them as human beings, God's own creation, regardless of the extent of their mental condition. For some, families have given up. If our husbands have given up, wives have given up on their husbands. Parents have given up on their children. This ought not to be so. They are human beings. You know, things can change. You know, things can be made right with proper intervention and proper treatment. So lastly, not last but one, the do's and the don'ts. Do not use stigmatizing things you should not do, the don'ts. Do not use stigmatizing language that labels people. Do not invalidate or dismiss feelings. Don't take their feelings for granted. Don't say because you know them, you are close to them. So what they are saying is irrelevant. Do not minimize their experience by saying it could be worse. Do not share personal information about others without their consent. Do not hear or emotionally abuse whenever frustrated by a patient. Do not encourage wishing away a mental illness. What you ought to do, use people's first language that shows acceptance. Try and use their first language. They will receive you. Listen actively to understand their feelings and needs. Practice empathy. Put out a bower of compassion, bower of mercy, by being mindful and respectful. Practice confidentiality and maintaining trust. Take breaks and get additional support as needed to prevent caregiver burnout. Encourage seeking medical treatment in conjunction with prayers. And lastly, I want to advise you, this condition could have been anybody's. It could have been you that is needing a caregiver. But thank God it's not you. So appreciate God and help those who are in need. Finally, and in summary, mental health serves as a foundation to our individual and collective ability as humans to think, relate with one another, earn a living, and enjoy life. For this reason, it is crucial that as a society, as a community, vital efforts are put into the promotion, protection, and restoration of mental health. Not only for our sake, but for our future generation as well. That is why I want to once more commend the president and the entire executive and members and staff of the Council of Nigerian Professionals for what they are doing for this education and for the information they are passing across to the entire society. With this, we all will be able to lead collectively, you know, the good sense of mental health with love, enjoy our life, contribute to our society, and by so doing, we will have good mental health. I want to thank you for listening and for having me. So I will want to leave, I will hand over to the president. I'm sure I will have some questions. There will be some questions so that I can quickly take some questions before we close.
Wow. Thank you so very much. Thank you so much, Dr. Gregory Osagie. Thank you so much. God bless you abundantly. I learned a lot. If you learned anything from this session, do you mind just type one thing that you learned in this session in the chat? I learned a lot. You talked a lot about stress. You talked a lot about the fact that people need to seek help. We need to talk to someone. We need to have someone in our corner. I learned a lot of professional jargons. Dopamine, oh my God. I learned a lot of things today. So please type one word that you learned. And you talked about you know, protective factors. You talked about how we can help, the resources available to us. You talked about knowledge being power. If we have the right information, it allows us to make informed decisions. Can we please all give a warm virtual thank you to Dr. for his time? He spoke for over 1 hour just to educate us. We have the reactions right there. Please just, you know, wave your hand, do thumbs up, whatever you want to do, just to appreciate him for all the information he has shared. I'm happy to say that this has been recorded. It will be on our website shortly. So on that note, I know that, and I kind of feel you did answer some of the questions, but I just want to read it just because it was posted. The first one is, how do we help someone who is in stress, I guess. I think that's what that person is trying to say. And that same person said, how do we help someone who is having chronic stress, especially when the person does not have work insurance or financially stable?
Okay. I will take them one by one.
Please.
Yes, how do we help somebody? It's about the same question. How do we help somebody who is stressed? How do we help someone who is having chronic stress, especially one or the person who does not have work insurance or financially stable? Now, number one, the person must realize that he or she needs help. You need to get to a level of understanding that I need help, because it could be difficult to begin to help one who does not feel that he or she needs help. Now, having said that, yes, there's a realization there that I need help. The person has to be a whole life reorientation and rework evaluation. Number one, he or she needs to know that stress, that's where counseling comes, that stress will ultimately lead to a chronic disease in the body. Will ultimately lead to a mental ailment. Therefore, there has to be a total reorientation. Now, somebody once said, I think Bishop Oyedepo said that you must be prepared to rest or be prepared to be laid to rest. You must rest or be prepared to be laid to rest. So you must understand that if you don't have a change in your work-life balance, a reorientation, you are going to have a chronic disorder, a chronic disease, and possibly, God forbid, nobody wants to die. So you must realize that. And once you have that, you must begin to put in place things that would make you alleviate your stress. Number one, you cannot kill yourself if you don't have to do 3-4 jobs to survive. If you must tailor your expense to what you earn, and if your job is beginning to tell on your head, then you have to cut down on the job. There's a saying that people, you know, use their head to make wet. And when they get old, they begin to use their wet to try and get their head back. But at that point in time, it's too late. Then, for somebody who is financially not stable, like I said, he or she has to, you have to tailor your income to your expense. Don't spend beyond what you earn. Because when, at the end of the day, you're on a negative balance, it puts a lot of pressure. What you don't need, you don't go for. Get a smaller apartment. If you stay in a big apartment or you are going for a mortgage to get a big apartment, which is far and over your income, don't do that. Live a low profile life that would guarantee you good health. It's of no use, no destroying your life and leaving your children as orphans without help. So I would advise you should seek counsel, and the counsel is that, you know, tailor your expenses to your income. Avoid stressful factors that would do damage to your health. Get enough sleep. Do exercises. Eat well and healthily. You know, meditation can also help you. So those are my advices for those who are, don't stress yourself. And if you have to probably go to school to upgrade your qualification and make better income, go to school. You can take a student loan and go to school and come back and begin to make better income. And by so doing, little by little, pay off your student loan. So upgrade yourself and avoid factors that would give you chronic disease and send you to where you don't want to go to. Let's be available for our children so that we can bring them up in the way we ought to bring them up. So number two, he says, say no to the stigma associated with, okay, man, that's just an advice.
Yes, those were just comments. I just wanted to add to the question that you already provided some free resources that people can take advantage of, whether it's the helpline, whether it's the CDC. Let's take advantage of all those because they're free. You don't need to have insurance for you to take advantage of those resources. And thank you, everyone, for putting in some words that you gained from today's session. Because of time, because we're supposed to end at 8:30, if you have any questions, please reach out to us at info@cmpngo.ca. We'll pack the questions and we'll send it to doctor to review for us. But we can still take one last question if there's anybody else that would like to ask a question. Just one question. Raise your hand or you are mute to ask the question. Thank you for sharing. So in the absence of any question, there was one that was really kind of interesting, but I think you kind of, you touched on it. It's the schizophrenia. It seems that that's the one that we tend to experience more in Nigeria. We tend to see people walking around. I mean, but we don't see that here. Are you able to provide some thoughts around that? Why is it because of neglect? Is that why they're where they are? Or what can be done to help people like that?
Yes, over here, the people are more educated. There's accessibility to Medicare here, early Medicare. And religion plays a lot of factor. Way back in Africa, in Nigeria, living in denial that is there, that this is demonic, is an evil spirit. And therefore, we have to look for a spiritual source to manage it. And by so doing, it becomes so chronic and it gets to the level of this altered state of perception, altered state as living in the world of their own. But why over here, it's Medicare is accessible, there's more education, there is early perception, and is handled early before it becomes so bad. As it gets over there where it becomes late, and it gets to a stage where they have to even throw up the address and be walking down the street nude. So that's a difference, a different environment entirely.
Thank you so much. So you mentioned dementia. Memory loss. Is there a way to slow this process down? Is there something that seniors can do differently to be able to slow this down, if at all?
Yes, there's nothing, even though it's a chronic disease, there are things you could, you know, good diet. At the level of seniors, you should avoid junk. Because we say one of the causes of dementia is a reduced blood flow to the brain and the brain cells. So junk food leaves plaque in the walls of the blood vessels. And if the plugs are, if the vessels are plugged, the lumen and the blood supply to the cells are reduced. So that's one major factor that can cause dementia. So we need to eat well. And also early treatment, like a sick early treatment. So by the time you begin to notice any of those memory loss, you begin to see that you are beginning to get forgetful, then seek Medicare, and by so doing, you're able to do early investigations and profile solutions. There are medications too that you can give that can help with the vitality of the brain cells. And if it's being caused by autoimmune diseases, you are able to provide medications that can slow it down. Yes, there are medications. And it's all brought down to early diagnosis and early treatment.
Thank you very much again, sir. Thank you so much. We really appreciate the knowledge you shared today, the insights you provided. And it's heartwarming to see all the comments as to what people gained from what you said. Thank you. We really, really appreciate you. Eric, do you mind going to the slide, please? Thank you. We're wrapping up. And so Share Care Engage, all about our seniors, is actually a 10-week program. The last week will be in person. Next week, we're having Dr. Oyeabioye talk about financial literacy. Our seniors need to understand the various ways that the financial system works here in Canada and how they can, benefit from it. Finance Matter is July 7th. And of course, July 14th, we're having Just to Sweat, Adenike Charles, talk about physical and healthy choices. Next, please. And so our social media, you can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, and everything that you see here. This session will be posted on YouTube as soon as possible. To reach out to us, email is info@cmpngo.ca. Our newsletter always provides information about what's upcoming. And if you want to advertise with us or you want to learn a little bit more, you can reach out to Mosun, who is our digital lead, at 647-778-0049. Next. And I'll just use this opportunity again to thank Dr. Greg Osagie. My father, thank you so much. Your presence is highly appreciated. Every time you spend with us, we do not take it lightly at all. We have gained from your immense wealth of knowledge. We really appreciate you. Thank you so very much. And we hope that we know we can always tap you on the shoulder whenever we need you. Thank you so much. And we pray that God will continue to give you the strength and the knowledge to continue to grow in him and to impact lives for good. Thank you so much. On behalf of CMP, I thank you. On behalf of our staff and volunteers and the community, we thank you. Thank you so very much. Thank you. To everybody that joined, did you want to say something, sir?
I said thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. To everybody that joined, thank you for spending your Friday, beautiful Friday evening with us. We really appreciate it. And to the staff and volunteers, thank you so much. And CMP, as always, thank you. We do have an event tomorrow. It is Understanding, Creating, and Protecting Generational Wealth is number 4. It is the various investments that you can actually make in your registered plan. So join us tomorrow at 6 p.m. Thank you, everyone, and we wish you a fantastic evening. Have a good day.